Good morning. Welcome to this worship service of Ada First United Methodist Church. My name is Reverend Brandy Rigsby, and it's a pleasure to be gathered this morning to see your smiling faces, to hear your voices and your laughter as we gather together today to worship our Lord and Savior. I want to welcome all of you. I want to welcome those who are visiting with us today, those who are joining us online. It's wonderful to be gathered as brothers and sisters to share together in this time of worship. I do want to offer a few announcements and reminders as we get started. We do try to keep our website and Facebook pages updated, so please feel free to go to those to find out what upcoming events there are. And of course, if you have any other questions, you can always call the church office or get a hold of me or Sasha for more information. We do have an offering basket in the back of the sanctuary, or a box. We do have an online giving option, and we truly appreciate your tithes, your offerings, your support of our church and its ministries. You allow us to provide the programs that we do, but also to be in missions with our community through our connections and our partnerships with places like the Ada Food Pantry and Beatitudes. So we thank you for your continued generosity and support. And speaking of thank yous, I want to say thank you to all those who came last week as we celebrated welcoming the Ohio Northern students back to campus with a potluck. Delicious food, as always. So those who brought dishes, those who helped set up and tear down and clean up, thank you so much for all the work that went into that. And what a wonderful time it was, a fellowship, and of course, filling our tummies. So thank you. Another reminder, the Harvest and Herb Parade is just around the corner this coming weekend. On the 21st, we will be participating in the parade. If you are able to come and ride on the float, we would greatly appreciate that. We'll gather behind the school near the cafeteria drive entrance at 9 a.m. on Saturday. The parade starts, I believe, at 10, so we kind of sit there, get in line, get ourselves organized during that time, but we'd love to have as many as possible to either ride the float or walk alongside and pass out candy and water bottles, which means we also need donations of candy and water bottles. Some of those have started coming in. If you're able to pick up those 20-ounce disposable water bottles, a case of those this week, and bring those in, or some bags of candy, we would greatly appreciate that. I had somebody recently ask, well, how much candy do we need? Well, whatever you bring, we will get rid of. I'll just put it that way. I believe last year we went through at least five-gallon buckets of candy. And those kids on the side of the street really love it. And some of it might disappear by those who are riding the float. But we greatly appreciate those decorations. And if you have any questions, please let us know. Also on September 29th, just a couple of weeks away, we are going to celebrate the baptism of baby Bennett Smith. If you remember, we had a baby shower reception planned for Bennett, and he decided to make his entrance into this world 6 weeks early, a little earlier than anybody had planned, so we postponed that. So now we're excited that on the 29th, we're going to celebrate his baptism and also kind of have that makeup baby shower as well. So we'll have a reception following the worship service downstairs in the fellowship hall right after worship. And we invite you to come to celebrate with the Smith family and to share together in fellowship. Our card ministry team will be meeting today in room 205 right across the hall following the worship service. If anyone is able to stick around and just fill out, sign a few of those birthday cards and anniversary cards, all the help we can get is appreciated and helps it to move a little bit faster. And of course, those who receive those cards during the month of their birthday are always blessed and thankful for that. So we're thankful to that team for that continued work. Now, friends, as we move into this time of worship, may we come expecting God's Spirit to be at work, to be speaking to us and moving in our hearts in this time and in this place. I invite you, will you join me in an attitude of worship? Thank you.
The voice of the Lord, strong and mighty, powerful and full of majesty. The voice of the Lord breaks forth.
It gives us strength and blessing, calling us to shout in praise. Glory to the name of the Lord.
Please remain standing to sing hymn 61 in the United Methodist Hymnal. This scripture reading is from Genesis 1, verse 1 through 5, found on page 1 of your pew Bible. When God began to create the heavens and the earth was without shape or form. It was dark over the sea, and God's wind swept over the waters. God said, "Let there be light." And so light appeared. God saw how good the light was. God separated the light from the darkness. God named the light day and the darkness night. There was evening and there was morning, the first day. The word of the Lord for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Moment and say thank you to Julie for playing piano for us this morning, and of course to our choir for being back again, and Scott may have a birthday today. I believe our choir serenaded him, so do you want to do it again, Julie? I saw you pull something out. As I reminded him, he'll always be older than me, so. Now at this time, I'd like to invite our children forward as Miss Wendy shares our message this morning.
How's everyone today?
Good.
Have you guys ever seen a baptism before? Yeah.
You did it, right?
You guys have seen it? Yeah, some of you guys were probably too little to remember your own baptism. Why do we get baptized? What do you think?
Do we just do it to wake the babies up with the cold water?
What do you think? Do you guys have any? To get raised by God. That's a beautiful answer. Thank you very much. That's absolutely correct. We get baptized because either our parents or ourselves, we're saying, God, I choose you. I claim you. Do you guys know what the word claim means? What's that? It's yours. That's correct. So when you claim something, you're saying, I choose you, you're mine. And God does the same thing to us when we get baptized. He chooses us. God chooses us every day, but it's a public way in front of your church and your family and your friends that we choose God, right? So let's talk about, do we get baptized every single day? No. How many times do we usually get baptized? One time, right? And we have different times through our life that we remember our baptism, right? We remember that we chose God. Well, in a course of a day, can you think of a time, maybe every day, where it's like a fresh start and where you can choose God? Can you think of a time every single day? No? Well, the first thing that came into my mind was when I showered, maybe? I don't know. I always feel fresh and clean when I shower, right? So that's maybe a little bit like baptism, but what about every morning? Is that a fresh start every morning? So every morning when you wake up, you get a fresh start to the new day, right? So sometimes if you're having a bad, bad, bad day and you're feeling grumpy and just mean and sad, do you ever just feel like you just want to go take a nap? Well, I know probably kids don't, but I bet almost all the adults out here would be like, yep, I need a nap. And you know what? Sometimes we do that because all of those negative things are constantly going in our head, and we just want to quiet those things. And when we wake up, we hope maybe we'll have a fresh start and feel better. So sometimes when you wake up in the morning, before you get out of bed and start worrying about school and what you're going to wear and how you're going to be with your friends, maybe take just a couple of minutes when you're laying in bed and say a prayer to God and remember that you are chosen by God and that God, you choose God and God chooses you. So maybe you can take a minute to remember that. And you can go out and show people that when you encounter them at school or at play. So can you guys take a minute and pray with me? Dear God, thank you for always choosing me. Let me remember to choose you every day and show the people I encounter. Amen.
This scripture reading is from Mark 1, verse 4 through 11, found in your pew Bible on pages 761 and 762. John the Baptist was in the wilderness calling for people to be baptized to show that they were changing their hearts and lives and wanted God to forgive their sins. Everyone in Judea and all the people of Jerusalem went out to the Jordan River and were being baptized by John as they confessed their sins. John wore clothes made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. He ate locusts and wild honey. He announced, "One stronger than I is coming after me. I'm not even worthy to bend over and loosen the straps of his sandals. I baptize you with the water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." About that time, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and John baptized him in the Jordan River. While he was coming up out of the water, Jesus saw heaven splitting open and the Spirit, like a dove, coming down on him. And there was a voice from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I dearly love. In you I find happiness." The word of the Lord for the people of God.
Good morning. We watched a movie Friday night with the girls, our stay home because we're in no condition to be out in the public kind of night. And as we were watching this movie, I started to wonder, have you ever considered if your life was a movie, who might those Hollywood directors cast to play the part of you? And I realized, honestly, of my daydreaming, I've never even made it that far. Because if my life was a movie, well, I found a picture that I think captures what my life would look like in movie form. Do we not have that picture? Okay, can you read that? Drop off kid, drop off other kid, work, pick up other kid, drop off one kid, drop off other kid, pick up kid, bring kid home, drop off other kid, text someone about picking kid up tomorrow, forget kid, pick up kid, feed kids, die. I don't know that that would really make a blockbuster hit that everyone would line up to see. Because the reality is the majority of my days feel pretty ordinary and mundane. And I can't say that God has ever come to me in a burning bush or a pillar of fire or a talking donkey. And if I'm being truthful, very rarely am I even looking for the presence or the work of God in those ordinary routines of my life. But in the words of Reverend Andy Crouch, perhaps one of the most stubborn Christian heresies is the idea that any part of our lives is secular, that any part of our lives is untouched and disconnected from the sacred work of worship and prayer. Friends, what if all of life, the big and the small, the extraordinary and the boring, what if all of the mundane moments from waking up and brushing our teeth to sitting in traffic and eating leftovers, what if every moment is actually a sacred moment? What if life is actually filled with sacred moments? God's presence seeping into every routine, God's voice speaking into every brief pause, God's gentle hand reaching into every mundane yet sacred moment, and the Spirit drawing us closer even in those ordinary moments, drawing us into deeper connection with our Creator. I'd say that's God's presence right there, right? We can't help but laugh and giggle when we hear it. Well, we are beginning a new sermon series based on, in part, by a book by Tish Harrison Warren, a book entitled Liturgy of the Ordinary. Our sermon series over the next several weeks will call us to pay attention to those ordinary, everyday routines in our lives, to notice the liturgy of our lives. Now, I know liturgy is one of those churchy words. Anybody ever use that outside a Sunday morning? But even here today, as we have gathered for worship, liturgy means the structure. We as Wesley followers, we love order and routine, don't we? It's in that rhythm that we find time and space to meet with our Creator. The songs we sing, the prayers we pray, the reading of Scripture, the receiving of sacraments, those sorts of things we've come to know as liturgy. However, in its Greek context, liturgy actually means more simply the way we do things. There's no specification that it only be in church. It can also mean the way we do things out there in the world. You see, even tomorrow, our lives will have order and rhythm. Our day will have liturgy. Every day we wake up, hopefully. We wake up, we get dressed, we eat breakfast, we brush our teeth. The order may be different, and the way we do it. Like, I know some of you probably jump up out of bed, ready to take on the world. And then I can see the rest of your faces, maybe a little more like me. I need a cup of coffee before my brain turns on for the day. But all the same, there are those elements that become routine. And if we pay attention, we can begin to notice the liturgy that will guide us into thinking more deeply about our connection with God. And so my hope and my prayer for this series is to challenge us to seek out those sacred moments. Those sacred practices that are already there in our everyday lives, but just waiting for us to notice them. So let's start at the beginning. My day usually begins at 6 a.m. when the alarm goes off for the first time. And I immediately shut it off because those extra 10 minutes, they really help me get myself in gear for the rest of the day to jump up and conquer the world, right? Well, my guess is most of us probably wake up more slowly, unless you have a newborn or you have a dog that's making that sound. That'll get you out of bed. But if we can, we like to linger for a moment, to reorient, to stretch, to wonder why our back hurts, to run through that list of things to do for the day. But in those first delicate seconds, writes Warren, and the blurry-eyed pause of waking before the tasks begin, before I get on with the day, I'm greeted with the truth of who I am. In my most basic self, who I am. Whether we're children or heads of states, we sit in our pajamas for a moment, yawning, messy hair, bad breath, unproductive, groping toward the day. Soon enough, we'll get buttoned up into our identities. As mothers, as business people, as students, friends, employees, soon enough, we'll spend our day conservative or liberal, earnest or cynical, fun-loving or serious. But as we first emerge from sleep, we are nothing but human, unimpressive, vulnerable, newly born into the day, blinking as our pupils adjust to the light and our brains begin to emerge to consciousness. In those moments, our accomplishments are not yet a matter of worry. And we realize somehow the world kept turning even though we weren't participating. Think about those seconds or minutes. That liminal space that we experience between sleep and waking up. when we are not yet who we will be, yet we are still something, still someone. Have you ever thought about the fact that until Jesus showed up to be baptized at the age of 30, he had really done nothing noteworthy? He had not yet preached to the crowds or healed the sick. He had not been crucified or even resurrected. When he showed up to the river that day, he was just the carpenter's son. He was standing in the crowd like everyone else, squinting his eyes from the sun and the feeling of sand stuck between his toes. You see, it's in those sacred moments before crawling out of bed in the morning that we, much like Jesus on the banks of the Jordan, we have not yet put on the world's identity for us. And yet as he emerged from the baptismal water, drenched, wiping his eyes, the heavens parted and a voice spoke. "This is my beloved son, with whom I am happy and pleased." Think about those words. I say similar words pretty often to my children after they get a good grade or they score a goal. Words, "I'm proud of you." But Jesus had not done anything impressive, nothing that we would consider worthy of pride. Of course, we expect words of acclamation after an extraordinary accomplishment. But instead, the Father's announcement of pride came before all the ministry and all the miracles. Do you see what that means? Every morning, before you brush your teeth or you fix your hair, before you look presentable or accomplish a single thing, just in opening your eyes to the light of a new day, God the Father is speaking that same pronouncement over you. "You, Kim, are my beloved child with whom I am well pleased. You, Terry, are my beloved child with whom I am well pleased." You may not have noticed the heavens part. I doubt a dove descended from your bedroom ceiling. You may not have even heard God's voice. But even before we roll out of bed or we have done a single productive thing, God's blessing is upon us. God's grace and God's blessing are there, spoken over each of us, whether we know it or not. As United Methodists, we practice infant baptism. As Warren explains, before that child can cognitively understand the story of Christ, before they can affirm a creed, before they can even sit up or speak, before they can contribute significantly to the work of the church, grace is spoken over them. She says, baptism is the first word of grace spoken over us by the church. And we are counted in that moment on as a child of God before we even have anything to show for ourselves. And if that wasn't enough, think about this. Because God's grace was already present in Jesus, just as it's already present in you, anything that Jesus did from that day forward, like anything you do from this moment forward, was and is not to gain God's approval, but rather it comes from this deeply rooted certainty that God's unconditional love already exists. I've shared this before, but Martin Luther would begin each day by remembering his baptism. Now, I know if you were baptized as a baby or a child, you cannot literally recall your baptism, but what he meant, and what we still mean when we utter those words, is that you are sealed by the Holy Spirit. And you must remember that you have been marked as Christ's own. Luther challenged the members of his community every morning to put on baptism as the daily garment which we are called to wear all the time. Remembering our baptism is always important, but remembering our baptism specifically as we wake up in the morning, when our breath smells and our hair's sticking up, before we want anyone else to see us. In those moments, there's something remarkable that happens in those waking moments. We are marked by an identity that is given to us by grace. An identity that is deeper and more real than any other identity we will wear that day. And let me tell you, we're only just getting started. The liturgy of our day has only just begun. There is still so much day before us, so much liturgy of the ordinary to unfold. Harrison writes, when Jesus died for his people, he knew me by name and the particularity of this day. Christ didn't redeem my life theoretically or abstractly. He didn't redeem the life I dreamed of living or the life that I know I should be living. He knew I would be in today as it is. My home where it stands, my relationships with their beauty and their brokenness, in my particular sins and struggles. He knew me in this moment. In this moment, God comes to us all in our waking, brushing our teeth as we eat, as we work, as we live. So may you see, may you feel, and may you know God's love and grace and redemption that are at work here and now, right in the middle of your ordinary, everyday, sacred life. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Julie and Scott, and thank you, choir. Friends, as we prepare to receive our gifts, our tithes, and our offerings, may we remember, may we know that God has brought us. God has brought us to this time and to this place, calling us to hear our identity, not in the voices there, but only in the voice of God. And to know that we have been called to participate in the kingdom of God here and now. So through these gifts, through our very lives, we offer to God all that we have and all that we are. I invite you now, would you please stand as you are able as we sing together the words of our doxology, "Praise God from whom all blessings flow." Be seated. Now, as we enter into this time of prayer, may we quiet our hearts and our minds. May we be present. May we be listening and expecting God to speak into this time and place. Will you join me in an attitude of prayer? Almighty God, Lord of heaven and earth, since the beginning, you have been with us and for us. Your Spirit hovering over the waters of creation. Your breath filling our lungs with life. And so we are gathered today in your presence with thanksgiving and praise for the ways in which you reveal yourself to us. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, we have come to know and to love you. Though we were dead through our sins, O Lord, in your mercy, you spoke a word of healing, and you made us alive again together with Christ. But you have set a path before us, O God, and instead we have wandered on our own. When you have called our names, we have turned from your voice. You have poured out grace upon grace, but we still seek the world's definition of love and success. Forgive us. Forgive us, Father, and may your mercy wash over us. May you remind us once more that you have called us your own. That you draw us into your loving embrace. And now, Almighty God, as your children, forgiven and enfolded in the grace of Jesus Christ, may you hear our prayers. Lord, we lift up Luis Lortz, Wendy Doherty's mom, who fell this past week and has suffered a small brain bleed. We offer our gratitude for the healing that she has already experienced. And we pray, Lord, that you will continue to be at work, giving her comfort and strength as she recovers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We lift up our church custodian, Debbie Ward, who is dealing with blood pressure issues. We pray, O God, that your hand will be upon her, bringing healing and relief. May she find assurance and peace and knowing that she is being lifted in prayer at this very moment. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We lift up Bob McCurdy, who is suffering from double pneumonia. We pray, O God, that your Spirit will bring healing and comfort. Though Bob has faced several setbacks following his knee replacement surgery, we are thankful that in every circumstance your hand has been upon him. May you continue to be present, giving him patience and strength for the days ahead. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And God, as we move into an election season, with so many voices shouting and seeking to pull us apart, may your Spirit unite our hearts with the call that you have placed upon us, a call to love you and to love our neighbor. May we seek to offer mercy and grace instead of hate. May we speak with love and act with compassion to all people at all times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We also continue to lift up Phil Compton, Linda Epley, Gary Ludwig, Ruth Reuter, Rob McCurdy, and Gary Clausen. We ask, O God, that your Spirit will fill each of these people. Fill their hearts with your comfort and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And now, in a moment of silence, we lift up those prayers which we each carry in our own hearts. We lift them up to you today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Mighty God, it is by your extravagant grace that we have been saved through faith. You created us in your image, and you have called us your own. Your workmanship, your masterpiece, not of our earning, but only by your love. Our identities sealed and our salvation secure. So now, O Lord, with your call rising up within us, may you give us eyes to see the needs of others. May you give us hearts that are burdened for others. And may you give us open hands to serve one another. May our very lives, every ordinary moment, be a testament to your mercy, your love, and your grace. We pray all these things in the name of Christ Jesus, who taught us to pray together by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, as children of God, called and claimed by the very voice of our Creator, may we stand with confidence to sing together our closing hymn, number 420, Breathe on Me, Breath of God. Please rise as you are able.
Oh,
these words of blessing from the 121st Psalm. Lift up your eyes. Where does your help come from? Our help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. God will not let you stumble and fall. The one who watches over you will never slumber or sleep. God will keep you safe. From your first breath to the last breath you breathe, from this day forward and forever. So may you go from here in peace and confidence, for God goes with you in the big and the small, in the extraordinary and the ordinary. Amen.